Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear.
Timothy chapter 2. We had looked last week at 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 23. Again, I'm going to probably ask you these questions. Maybe do it every week, just kind of get it in your mind. Paul wrote this letter to Timothy. Timothy is in what city? Do you remember?
Ephesus.
Ephesus. Ephesus. And where is Paul when he writes this?
He's in jail.
And where do you think he's in jail at?
Rome.
Okay. And have you looked on the maps in the back of your Bible to see?
It's quite a bit.
I don't have my Bible.
I told you when I looked on the internet.
I think it's like a week away or better, or 3 weeks away, something like that.
How many miles? According to one site that I went to, said roughly 1,250 miles. So Paul has written this letter that has to be taken over to Timothy. And at the end of the letter, he asks Timothy, please come see me. I want to see you one more time. He feels like his time is almost up. You can read that in the fourth chapter. But these are kind of like the final thoughts that the Apostle Paul was giving to Timothy. And I don't know if you've ever given thought to it, but if you knew that your time here on earth was about up, would you find yourself wanting to pass on, you know, the most important bits of knowledge or whatever that needs to be tended to?
Yes.
So here at the end of the second chapter, we had looked last week at verse 24, and this is where it ties into what I said about the angel's wings. The Apostle Paul said in verse 23, don't have anything to do with foolish and stupid arguments, because you know they produce quarrels. I used an illustration of back in the early church history. What was one of the things that they quarreled about? Do you remember the illustration that I used? I found out about this when I was at seminary. It has to do with Adam. The question was that since Adam was created rather than born.
Oh, his belly button.
Did Adam have a belly button?
Yeah.
And it was an argument that took place within the early church, and I don't know if there were, you know, it was a split over or whatnot, but it's amazing the things that some people want to argue about.
Mm-hmm.
What are some of the things that we can argue about today? Well, within our churches, and people say, well, this is not a stupid argument. You understand where I'm coming from. We do believe that Jesus is coming again, right?
Right.
Right? Now, the thing that people argue about is Jesus coming before the tribulation, which means that it's a pre-tribulation rapture. And people say, what's the tribulation? In the book of Revelation, it talks about the tribulation. It's a 7-year period of time in which God basically judges here on earth. And the way that he judges, he allows basically evil to, and he sends punishment. He sends all sorts of, that's what a lot of those judgments that you read in the book of Revelation, they're taking place during the tribulation. Some of those things are just horrendous.
Yeah.
That he allows to take place. So is Jesus coming before that 7-year period of time, which would mean a pre-tribulation rapture? Is he going to come in the middle of the tribulation, which is mid-tribulation rapture, or is he going to come at the end of the tribulation, which would be a post-tribulation rapture? And let me say, there are major Christian influences, you know, people that we respect in each one of those camps.
Right.
And sadly, sometimes it can lead to divisions. What I tell people, and I tell people what my personal belief is, and I think that my dad shares it, but my dad and I both believe that going to come after the tribulation. And there's the majority of Christians these days, they believe in a pre-tribulation rapture. But here's what I say. Rather than it allowing us to become divided, the thing that we can agree on is Jesus is coming
back. Coming back.
Amen.
And the important thing is that you and I be ready,
ready.
Whenever he does come.
Yes.
He is coming again.
Yes.
And I personally hope and pray that we as Christians don't have to go through the tribulation. I don't want to go through it. I mean, you can read in the book of Revelation. What are some of the things that trouble you the most about the plagues that come during the tribulation? Any of them come in
the
mind?
Scorpions, they're the size of a horse, and they bite them, and they don't die. They
torment people. It's excruciating pain that lasts for months.
Months, and the blood flowing in the streets up to the briars of horses. And
there's some scary stuff in there. I think about the hailstones.
Yes.
And it talks about the hailstones that are going to fall. What are they, like 75 pounds?
Yeah.
They're huge. And you say, they can't get that big. I just read the other day that out west, with one of the storms that recently came through, and I saw a picture of it. They
it
said
was
that it was the size
like
of
a baseball
grapefruit.
Or
golf. It was as big as a grapefruit.
Yeah.
But at any rate, it's going to be a terrible time of judgment. I pray that the church is out of here. I pray that we don't have to go through that.
Well, the plagues in the Exodus was something. But
yes.
This is going to be.
Yes. Yes. So, yeah, you can go back and you read about the plagues that took place with the Egyptians before
yes.
the children of Israel.
Yes.
So, not to spend any more time on this, but it said that, you know, what, all that you're going to do is quarrel about stuff. The thing that I use from modern day that people will quarrel about, and I use, not to pick on them, but the older guys that sit down at McDonald's, and they want to argue about who is the greatest baseball player of all time. Or the greatest football player. And everybody's going to have their favorite person.
That's right.
And you're not going to change anybody's opinion.
No.
And you're not going to come up with a consensus everybody's going to agree on. And so the Apostle Paul is just saying within the church, guard yourself within the church that you don't become sidetracked with just quarrels that there's really not going to be any answer to. The only thing that's going to do is create friction. And it can happen. If you want to talk about things that people sometimes can get to quarreling about, they can quarrel about the color of the paint that's going to be used in the sanctuary, the quality of the carpet, the color of the carpet, where you're going to put. And the Apostle Paul is just saying to Timothy, just make sure that people within the church focus upon the most important thing. Don't allow stupid arguments to enter it. Instead, he says in verse 24, the Lord's servant must not quarrel. Don't quarrel. Instead, the Lord's servant must be, and he talks here about some qualities to look for that are good not only for the person that's, you know, servant of the Lord, but in all of us are servants. But he says, the servant must not quarrel. Instead, he must be
gentle.
Yours says gentle. Mine's New International Version.
Mine says gentle and...
What does yours say?
Kind.
Kind.
Mine or how I got one from here.
Teach
okay.
and patient, mine says.
Okay, and we'll get to the others, those next two, the able to teach. But at any rate, mine says, and I think I use the 1988 version of New International Version, but he says, instead he must be kind,
mm-hmm.
yours says gentle, to
everyone.
Everyone. Did your parents ever tell you, now be nice.
Mm-hmm.
Be nice. I don't care how obnoxious the person is. Be nice. Be kind. Let that be your trademark. Told you before about the lady that in the nursing home, she said that back when she was a girl growing up, she really admired wealthy people, you know, because They had the nice clothes, they had the nice car, they had the nice house. She said she also admired very popular people. You know, she wanted to be, because everybody kind of looks up to these people and idolizes and whatnot. Then as she went through life, she really got to where she valued and looked up to smart people. You know, man, she looked up, and she goes down through the list, but then at the end of her life, she finds herself in a care facility. And she says, now at this stage of my life, what I really look up to are kind people.
Amen. Yeah. Really?
And it's a good reminder to us of what's most important, to learn to be kind. So he says, instead of being somebody within the church that's going to be quarreling, learn to just be kind. I say this about my dad. My dad's a retired pastor, but it always amazed me as a kid growing up that it didn't matter who the person was, he tried to treat everybody the same with kindness. And I remember when I was in high school, there was a lady within the church that she had an affliction. And I don't remember exactly what the affliction was, but she called repeatedly, called her house repeatedly. And our immediate reaction, because we're kids just growing up, it's her again, you know, one of those things. But the thing that amazed me was, it didn't matter how many times the lady called, my dad always treated her with respect and kindness. And Paul was saying to Timothy, try to instill that within the congregation that you're working with there at Ephesus. Help them to remember to try to be kind to everybody. And let me throw this out there for you. That even means to be kind to a telemarketer. Believe it or not. But if I'm kind to them, they might call back. Yeah, but they might be. You might be the only kind voice
that they hear.
That they hear during the course of the
day. I have a testimony about that.
Okay.
I was watching a commercial on CBS or something about I have United Dual, and I get $125 once a month for groceries and healthy stuff. Okay, they pay for it. They scan the card. Well, I run out, right? Well, these people are getting $300, same insurance. So I called the number, and I got one person, another person, and another person wasn't there, and I got a man called Matthew. He said, how can I help you? And I told him. He said, well, let me check. Give me your number. The card number. And he said, where are you? I said, West Virginia, Brook County. He says, well, those people live in California and New York and Texas. He said, you're allowed what you are because you're in West Virginia. And I said, thank you very much, sir. Anything else I can even do? You answer your, you know, the survey. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
So many times there's an explanation behind things.
So now I know why. Mm-hmm. He says, just don't pay attention to those commercials.
Yeah.
Advertisements.
Yeah.
Yes.
You mean there's misinformation out there?
Oh.
Really?
Yeah.
So it says, learn the Lord's servant must be kind to everyone, and that means all of us. It doesn't just mean the pastor. It means all of us. Why I struggle so mightily to be kind to Turtle. He's a good guy. He's a good guy. All right. So be kind to everyone. Second thing that we're looking for is
able to teach.
Able to teach. And I wondered if the person can be a good teacher, or if it's the person is teachable. And most of the stuff that I read is that the person is able to be a good teacher. What is necessary in order to be a good teacher? Well,
patience.
You've got to have knowledge and you've got to have skill of what you're doing, but you just nailed it. The thing that is needed most is a patient attitude toward people learning. I don't know how successful she's not here tonight, but Robin, years ago, when I first came here, for probably the first 10 years that I was here, I tried teaching piano lessons here.
Yeah, you did.
at the church. And Robin was one of my students. And some of the students would actually try. And when I say try, it's not just coming and sitting down at the piano and trying on here. It's during the rest of the week, they actually go home and practice something. I can't tell you the number of students that I would have to come in from week to week. And you could tell it was obvious. They hadn't even looked at the piano since they were here the week before. And let me just say, for anybody that's out there wanting to learn piano, you don't learn piano that way.
No.
You gotta stay at it. I don't care if it's piano, guitar, whatever, you gotta stay at it. But many times I would feel very frustrated. And sometimes a teacher might say, you know what, just don't waste my time. And quite honestly, I did kind of have to reach that point with a couple that I ended up having to say, you know what, I appreciate your willingness to say that you want to learn, but there's really not much that I can do if you're not willing to try to do something on your own. But the attitude toward wanting to teach people is that I'm going to be patient with you. I'm going to work with you. And teaching somebody doesn't mean just showing them one time. It means you go over a second time and a third time. Those of you that have been parents know what it is to constantly repeat yourself. You feel like you've got dementia. You repeat yourself so much. And the Bible says that's another quality that God's looking for with any servants. People that are willing to just kind of patiently work with the person and help them to come to a new understanding. And then the third thing that he talks about here, the person is first kind, second able to teach, and then the third thing is, what does your translation say?
Well, this says patience.
Yeah.
Patient.
Okay. Mine says the Lord's servant must not quarrel, instead he must be kind to everyone, able to teach, and Sheila, what does the next part say?
Not resentful.
Not resentful. What does that mean?
You don't resent other things, what people have or what they do or anything.
Okay. Are any of y'all resentful?
Not any longer.
Not any longer?
No.
I'll use this as an illustration. Do any of you resent it when you get corrected?
Not now. I don't.
Okay.
I'm yes. Not upper, but I'm old. I'm 72 years old. Why would I resent being corrected? I need to be corrected.
Okay.
I do.
That's a good attitude.
I think it depends on how you get corrected, how they say it to you.
Okay.
Because sometimes people say things and the tone of voice, different look, and you're like,
I resent that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't want to be bothered. Don't talk to me like I'm a 2-year-old kid.
Okay.
I'm an adult. You respect me and treat me like an adult. And you tell me in a way that don't make me feel like I'm dumb and stupid.
Amen. Respect. It goes a long way.
Exactly.
It really does.
You know, when you talk to somebody, you have to watch your words and how you pick them.
But again, even if somebody doesn't give you respect, you try not to resent that
right.
person.
And I just...
And it could be that you don't like them for whatever reason, but you don't resent. And the Word of God is saying resentfulness is a bad quality for any of us. And so Paul is writing to Timothy, just remember this for yourself and try to ingrain that within people. They may not like what you have to say, or you may not like what they have to say.
Exactly.
But don't allow that resentment to keep you from serving God. All right? So going on to this last part, because it kind of ties into this, those who oppose him. So the servant of the Lord, if there's somebody that is opposing him, he must continue to gently instruct them. I'm going to keep telling you what needs to take place here. I know that you may not like it, but I'm not going to, you know, be forceful about it, but this is what needs to be done. So he says, Those who oppose him, he must gently instruct. Why? In the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth. So this really does deal with the word that you talked about, patience. Just patiently working with the person, allowing God to work in their lives and to teach them. I know that all of us have probably had people that are very difficult to deal with. Mm-hmm. And at times you just kind of want to wash your hands of them once and for all. You might even have some co-workers, April, that are like that.
And God says, super glue and glue their mouth shut sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Shouldn't humility be in there somewhere?
It probably is.
I mean, I'm not saying, I know it is, but I think being...
Well, in order to do this, you've got to have a humble spirit.
Yes, mm-hmm. You do.
You know, you can pull out your pride card and say, you're not going to treat me this way, and I'm going to really forcefully make you do what I want you to do. But you continue to model Jesus Christ, who created everything, and yet you never saw him take that approach. He humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. So he says, you just patiently work with these people. And you pray that God's going to grant them repentance. You know, just kind of like, Susan, not to pick on you, but the situation with your sons.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure many times you've been at the point of just wash my hands totally and completely, but, and I know that you're limited with any contact with them at all, but...
Yeah.
You patiently just continue to try to do the right thing and pray that God is going to bring that person to a right relationship. So to finish up here in the 26th verse, that they will come to their senses, and escape from the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. Satan is the one that basically leads us down this path that says, you need to do it this way, and then the Word of God comes and says, don't keep doing it that way, because if you keep doing it that way, it's going to continue to make a mess within your life. You need to start following the Spirit. And if you follow the Spirit's going to end up bringing you freedom that you never knew before. So, Paul is concerned. Do any of y'all know much about the church at Ephesus?
They had a lot of false gods, didn't they? Idols and stuff.
Probably the most notable, that, of course, we've got the book of Ephesians.
Right.
And that's Paul writing a letter to the church at Ephesus. There are those that wonder maybe it was a circular letter. And he spent a good bit of time in the city of Ephesus, but over in the messages to the churches. In Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3, the very first message to the church was to the church of Ephesus. And what was the message to the church at Ephesus in Revelation chapter 2? Do any of you know?
No, I think there's one.
It said to the angel of the church in Ephesus, and the angel probably refers to the minister of the church, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven gold lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked men, that you've tested those who claim to be apostles and are not, and have found them false. You've persevered and have endured hardships for my name and have not grown weary. So there's some good things that church at Ephesus had done. But he said in the next verse, yet I hold this against you, you have forsaken your first love.
Yeah.
Remember the height from which you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. I'll just kind of end it right there, but they didn't love God like they used to. And you say, well, how did they used to love God? Do any of y'all remember the story of how the church at Ephesus used to love God? Go back to Acts chapter 18. The Apostle Paul had gone to the city of Ephesus, and there were a lot of people that kind of got converted, and they brought to the Apostle Paul a bunch of scrolls. What was notable about the scrolls? They had to do with false religion. They had to do with kind of witchcraft and other sorts of things. And the Apostle Paul said, we need to burn all of those scrolls. And so they burned the scrolls. And the Bible makes note of how much those scrolls were valued at. Do any of you remember how much the scrolls were valued at? 50,000 drachmas. If you want to go back and read this, the account with me, Acts chapter 18, I think it is.
Was it like a year's wage or something?
Yeah.
A lot more than that, April.
I think it was like five or something, wasn't it?
Yeah, chapter 19. I said 18 is chapter 19. And I was looking. Verse 19, chapter 19, verse 19. A number who had practiced sorcery brought their scrolls together and burned them publicly. When they calculated the value of the scrolls, the total came to 50,000 drachmas. How much was a drachma?
Was a silver coin worth about a day's wages?
A day's wages.
Yeah.
So it would be 50,000 days wages. How many days a year do you work typically? April?
No.
Let me simplify it for you. You work basically 50 weeks a year. And you work 40 hours a week. So if you multiply 50 times 40, it comes up to what? Dan, you're good with numbers.
Zero.
One more zero.
2,000.
2,000. So you're basically working 2,000 hours a year. But this is 50,000 days wages. You're only working out of a year 300 days maybe. I know if you're a school teacher, I'm trying to beat up our school teachers. School teachers work roughly 200 days out of a year. When I say that, kids are required to go to school 180 to 200 days, somewhere in that neighborhood. But you got 50,000. In fact, if I just simplify this right quick, if you said a day's wages was $100, 50,000 drachmas means that there was $5 million was the value of these scrolls. And I said before, if you had something that was worth $5 million, what would you do with it?
Put it in a safe. See, my question is, they were worth that, but they burned them. And it's, so they're worth nothing. So why
did they burn them?
Because they were evil.
And so here's my question. Suppose you found, an artifact that was valued at $5 million, but it was something that was used as an artifact in pagan worship, and you're faced with a decision. Do I sell this thing on eBay and pocket $5 million? Or because this thing is associated with pagan worship, something that was very bad and it was an abomination to God, do I take and destroy it?
Throw it in the dumpster of the Lethean Manor. Or throw it in the,
And I'm simply trying to put this in terms of what do you do? It's kind of an ethical decision. And the people during the time of Ephesus, they said, there's no doubt about what we'll do. We don't want these scrolls to get in the hands of anybody else, even though we could sell them and make $5 million, which would have meant a lot of money for them. Let's destroy them. And they never thought twice about it.
Right.
Why did they do that? Because they loved God more than anything else. God saw those things as evil, and they said that needs to be our attitude. We see them as evil as well. And so God is just basically saying to this church at Ephesus, that's the way that you used to love me.
But
you don't love me like that anymore. The old days, God was more important to them than anything else. That's not the way they felt about God now. And God says, that's what you need more than... There's a lot of good things that he said. You've persevered through all sorts of things, but the problem is, you don't love me the way that you used to. And that's very problematic. So, Paul wants this church, these Christians that Timothy is working at in the city of Ephesus, to really survive. I think that they've found ruins. I know that there's all sorts of ruins there in the city of Ephesus. I'm wanting to say that they did find some ruins of where that church, you know, was located at one time. But Paul wants this church to survive, and he's saying to Timothy, Timothy, I'm telling you right now, these are the things that you really need to emphasize. We're not going to have time to get into it tonight. Next week, Lord willing, we'll get into that third chapter. This is a passage of scripture that my dad quotes all the time, especially in light of what's going on in the world today. Mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. And we're seeing that because it goes into that chapter. I'm not going to go into detail tonight. It says people will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of the good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying his power. And the Apostle Paul says, have nothing to do with them. And it doesn't mean that you're going to be able to isolate yourself from all these people. It's just making sure that those people don't influence you, because that is not who the people of God are. You can just about take every single one of those descriptions that he uses in the first part of that chapter, and God wants you to be the opposite of what it's saying there. It's a very descriptive list of what we're seeing within our society these days, with the disobedience and the unholiness. There's just absolutely nothing sacred anymore. So Paul is trying to prevent that from happening with the city of Ephesus. Ephesus, again, was a very ungodly city. That's where the Temple of Artemis or the Temple of Diana was. It was one of the seven great wonders of the world. People traveled from all over the world there. We don't know a lot about the worship that took place there, but we believe that it had to do with so many of those religions did back then, fertility cults. And it wouldn't have been surprising if within the church there were not both male and female prostitutes. So it was very ungodly. And the Apostle Paul said, that kind of behavior is never going to survive. All that it's going to breed is destruction. The only thing that will survive is godliness. So do you have any questions or comments? Remember the kind of servants that you're supposed to be. Be kind to everyone. Be able to teach. Don't be resentful. Got your marching orders. Let's have prayer. Father, your word is, we just take time to think about it. Yeah, I know that people can just sit at home and they can pull out the Bible. And we do that. We just take and kind of read through something, but we may not sit there and think about what it's particularly trying to tell us. And it's really trying to tell us the sort of people that you want us to be. We confess that we come up short in so many ways, but we pray that you might help us to take to heart what your word says and to learn that we might better become the people that you call us to be. Thank you for the time that you've given us to be together tonight. Please keep us in your care as we go from this place, and guide us in our activities this week, that we will be a good witness for you. And we pray that you will bring us back the next appointed time, but use us for your glory. We do love you. In Jesus' name we pray.